everyone. Welcome to the first KCA meeting of the year. And we have two wonderful guests here tonight. I'll try and keep the announcements brief because you didn't come here to hear me. You came to hear these two gentlemen. As always, we'd like to give mahalos to our membership. If I can steal something from Maui Meadows, it's the membership that makes these meetings. Otherwise, I'd be here talking to myself. So the members are very important to these meetings. So thank you. And also to our committee members. The committee drives the board through the input of the community to make our decisions. So we always want to give thanks to them, to the volunteers, to the Kihei Charter School, which hosts us at each of these meetings. And remember that this is their house. They just invite us in for these meetings. And also, special thanks, because we don't always have them, thanks to Akaku for offering the opportunity for the people who can't be here to see the presentation on Akaku Maui Community Media. So thank you, Akaku. Okay, by our bylaws, we have to announce at this first meeting of the year the four officers of KCA who were elected by the board at the first meeting. Starting with the least first, you can see I'm up here again, so yep, you're stuck with me as president for another year. And welcoming back two outstanding officers. One is Patricia Stillwell, who is our treasurer. And Harry Hecht, who is our vice president. And this year we have a new secretary, and that's Mary Trotto standing over there. So that's our team for this year, and we'll do our best to live up to the reputation of KCA. Our next meeting is March 15th. As you know, we've gone to every other one. We'll give some details on that toward the close of the meeting. Okay, Mary, would you come up? Mary is going to make an announcement on Holly Kaukau. And Mary, we have instructions that stand close to the table, and that way Akaku can...
Thank you. Hello, everyone. This is my second hat. I'm the chair of fundraising committee for Holly Kaukau this year. And some of you may know that this is our 25th anniversary. We have been serving food at Holly Kaukau for 25 years. 1.1 million meals have been served. Many of you may not realize it, but our biggest growth is with the elderly and the disabled homebound. We are now delivering 80 meals a night to the elderly and the disabled. We serve about 70 to 75 meals from the kitchen to anyone who comes who's hungry. So that's what we do at Holly Kaukau. And you can imagine that's a lot of food and a lot of things to buy. So we have our annual fundraiser. I have some posters here. If you would like to put something up in your business or in your condo, you can take a poster. The annual fundraiser is March 4th at the Kealani Ballroom. And featuring the Maui Pops are going to perform for us since our 25th anniversary. And we're going to have some special entertainment by the Maui Pops Orchestra. So it's really going to be a fun evening. The tickets are on sale now at Holly Kaukau. And right now they're going for $125. And in a couple of weeks, that's the early bird special. All right, so, and we also invite those of you who may belong to clubs. Those of you who belong to clubs, we're offering a special for anyone who buys a table of 10 for $125 a ticket. So thank you very much, and thank you for all your support. We cannot do it without everyone's support from the entire community, from the county and the mayor's office, which has been very supportive of us, to all the businesses and the individuals who support us over the years. Thank you. Aloha.
Thank you. My eyes are not as good as they used to be. You know, everything gets weaker as you get older, unfortunately. But as I scan I believe, with the exception of this gentleman's, my immediate left, the only elected official I see here is our South Maui representative, Kaneala Ng, sitting up in the back. And not only are we glad to see him, we're especially glad for those of you that are from Maui, the state legislation opens tomorrow. So he made sure he could stay here for this meeting before he has to go over and get involved with that short burst of energy. And as I always tease all the representatives, yeah, you only work a couple months of the year, right? And then you're on vacation. But he knows I smile when I say that. And so thank you for being here, Representative. Lastly, I wanted to give recognition. I think our community and certainly KCA has been blessed with our history of community police officers. And there was a lot of distress toward the end of the year when we lost them both, bang, bang. And I was on the chief's door saying, we need community police officers. Well, we're blessed. I believe it. They were actually put in December 1st. And I think, yep, there they are. They're both way in the back, very humbly hiding. And I will do my best to get their names correct. When I was first given the longer name, it was misspelled from the official police department, but I got a correction on it. So it's Jared Dudoit?
Dubois,
thank you. And if I don't get my tongue wrapped around my eye teeth so I don't see what I'm saying, it's Taylor Kamawiwiwole. Close. That's that Howley tongue. But thank you very much for coming to the first meeting, and our community really appreciates the good work you do. So we'll look forward to working with you. Thank you. Okay, I'll stop babbling here. I think that's all that's required. And the process is going to be each of our presenters will start off with a 3-minute presentation. And we're doing it in alphabetical order. And it can't be in front of AA, that's for sure. So the mayor will go first for 3 minutes. Then Mark Hyde will take his 3 minutes. I'll break in and make a couple of quick announcements on procedures, and then we'll switch places that Mark Hyde will go first, and that's for the longer 15-minute period, and then, of course, the mayor will wrap up with his 15 minutes, then we'll go to audience questions. And guys, please remember, it's questions. I'll reinforce that later, but it's not statements, it's not dialogue, it's questions. Okay, without further ado, please welcome our two guests, Mayor Alan Arakawa and Mark Hyde.
We're just checking the microphone because we have to make sure it goes on. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. You know, the very fact that you are here tonight, really, this is why we have a mayor system, where you can actually see what's going on with your representative, elected representative, and you're able to have a say in what's happening in your community. The mayor being there has to come out to the community for almost everything that we're asked for to participate, because as part of the electorate, you control the votes that keep him in power and in office. I can tell you when your president came to me the first time and we started the pump, don't dump program because there were feces in the water, we had to take immediate action and we started working together on it. When I was in charge of the county council committee on planning, we came out and we talked to every community association to get the plans for this community put together. It takes cooperation, and it takes working together. But if we switch systems, it will deprive all of you of the ability to have a say in who your mayor is going to be in a meaningful way. Right now, we have a system by charter that clearly spells out all of the different duties of the council and the mayor, and it allows to have a check and balance system, whereby if the council does something that the mayor doesn't like, there's a check. If the mayor doesn't do something that the, or does something that the council doesn't like, there's a balance. So many times we have discussion and debate, and many times that debate results in a better solution for this community. If we change system, we won't have the need for that debate, and in all probability, you won't have that debate, because under the proposed system, the council would have the ability to just appoint a manager.
One day, Mr. Mayor.
Yes. You won't have a say in it. You won't have a say as who that manager is going to be, where he's from, whether he's from this community, what his background is, what his qualifications are. Is that what you want? You know, just the other day we had the Martin Luther King celebration. And they, you got to remember that many people in this community, in our country, didn't have the ability to vote at one time or another. And there have been huge battles to be able to get that vote to you, the public, for you to have your say. Every mayor, every governor, and the President of the United States are elected. If the larger communities and the larger jurisdiction were going to be run better by someone who was appointed, we wouldn't have those in our governor and our president. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Okay. Next we have Mark Hyde.
Thank you very much. Is this on?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. I'm an advocate for... Hello?
This
one? Working. This one's good. Thank you very much. I think I've got it. I'm an advocate for council manager government. The primary difference between the system that we have now and council manager government is that in our current system, under our mayor, we have both the executive function and we have an administrative function. And what council manager government does in particular is to recognize the differences between those two functions, separate them out, have an elected mayor, but have a professional manager take responsibility for day-to-day operations of the county. So at the upper level, you still have the policy debate going on. And you still have and can have an elected mayor with a veto to check the council. Underneath that, you have an operations professional, and this is very different, who hires the directors, and the manager is selected not at the polls, but based upon a job description, minimum requirements, for instance, that you have background, experience, education, and training in management, because that is the job of the manager, and the skills to be elected a mayor are entirely different than the skills to run a complex operation. That's basically the difference. I believe in the council manager government form, there's greater accountability to the people. In the elected mayor form, thank you. In the elected mayor form, we have an election, a mayor is elected, the next election is 4 years later. If that mayor is re-elected in the second term, if things go awry, there's no accountability because the mayor terms out. Here's the difference. In the county manager form, the manager is hired to do a job and has a relationship with the county that's called at will. subject to goals and objectives and performance criteria. And that is a constant throughout the term that that manager serves. And the people that you elect as council are the ones who choose that manager. And so you have that book because they're elected every 2 years, not every 4 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Now they'll each be giving a 15-minute presentation in a moment, and in fairness, now we're going to flip-flop the order. So Mark, even though Mark just spoke, he'll speak again, and that way he goes first to this portion, and the mayor goes next. Once they're both finished, then we will open it up to questions. And again, please cooperate. Somebody will be roving around with a microphone. They're not going to hand you the microphone, they're going to hold it for you so people don't go on and ask you questions. We have been there, and I think most everybody has seen that happen. So it's a question on the topic. It's no statements, no proclamations, no dialogue. You don't get to give an introduction before your question, just your question. And it's on this topic of governance. Please, nothing about GMOs or mega malls or cane burning or any other issue. There is time and place for that. That's not here for tonight. We want to use Hawaiian values, aloha, pono, but we need your cooperation to do the same thing. And if you don't, if you neglect it, well, then the microphone is gone and it will go on to somebody who is cooperating. So I'm trying not to be too hard-nosed about it, but I don't want somebody to say, oh, I didn't realize that, so I want to be perfectly clear. Those of you who have been here a lot, you know that's how we operate. And some people take advantage of it, and we're asking you, please don't give everybody a fair chance. Okay, now with that, that forewarning of the question portion, which will come up in about 30 minutes, again, we have Mr. Hyde going to speak for his 15-minute portion.
Thank you, Mike. I believe that county government can be made more accountable, transparent, and cooperative through a restructuring and a reforming and refocusing of it through a few discrete charter changes that focus first and foremost on the employment of a professional manager to deal with the operations of the county. And second, I believe it's important to free the manager and the directors such that they are selected and retained in a manner that is free from politics. Because you see, in our charter right now, at the end of every mayor's term, they all go. They all go. And the deputies go. There is an exit of about 30 people all at once. I also believe that by creating a culture of professionalism that is organized around professional management and a hiring process that focuses on the criteria for the job to be done, that we can create a culture here that is different from the one that we have now, less political. Politics are fine at the policy level. Politics don't belong in operations. Now, I should explain why I care about this and how I got involved. It began about a year and a half ago when I met with a gentleman in Kihei who had written some letters to the Maui News, and he was concerned about the recycling of local politicians through the executive branch of government. And that concerned me too. And it coincided with my involvement in the Mega Mall case. Now Mike said don't talk about it, but I have to tell you that that case that was prosecuted by the county on behalf of a developer when it violated a state land use commission order. It violated the countywide policy plan in favor of smart growth, and it violated the community plan. I stepped back and I wondered why. And the why that I ultimately came to is that we have a government that is unduly influenced in its decision making by politics. This was an operational issue. It was an issue of law. So that's why I am here tonight. Now, just as troubling, our general plan took 22 years to update. And our community plans, on average, are 18 years old. Everyone is struggling with the process. I mean, I attend council meetings and listen to the frustration that is expressed with the time that it takes. I'm also frustrated with it, but what I don't see is leadership being applied to question the process. What do we need to do to make things better? Now, it's increasingly difficult here in Maui County to have that dialogue because the relationship between the executive branch and the legislative branch is broken. There's been finger pointing, name calling. The county council has erected its own website. They're now looking at how can we hire an attorney to represent us because the county attorney does not represent us. Now, you know, there are costs associated with that, and there's downtime, and because people are not working together, the people's business is not getting done as efficiently and effectively as it should be done. Now, we can change this. It's not really a people issue, it's a process issue. And the problem is, at its core, is that our 50-year-old charter, which was adopted in the late 1960s, no longer works for us. And if we change the charter to do some very simple things, we can have a more responsive government. And that's founded on the hiring of a professional manager to run the operations, who has the background and experience and education in those things, who is hired explicitly on his or her qualifications for the job, and who is free, I'll say, from the corrosive effects of money. Now, you may not know this, but the council manager form of government is the most prevalent form of local government in America. Now, most people don't know that. In Hawaii, it doesn't exist, although Kauai is now looking at it. But for cities and counties our size, it is the most popular model. And there's a reason for that, because when you get to a certain level of complexity, it really is almost impossible to find in one person not only the skills to become an effective politician and run for office, but the skills that it takes to manage a very complex operation. And incidentally, a lot of it is highly regulated, whether it's wastewater treatment or waste disposal or highways and so forth. It requires a different skill set. Now, IBM did a study about 3 years ago and said they looked at the 100 largest cities in America, and they evaluated both the model that we have and the council manager model. And after doing that, they concluded that the council manager model is 10% more efficient. Now, if you literally translate that in Maui County, that's $70 million a year. Now, I frankly think that that underestimates the cost, because what IBM was looking at is only the internal costs to the city or county. But when you have a city or county that is unnecessarily bureaucratic or missing opportunities or making it difficult to do business. There are external costs that are significantly higher, and none of those are factored in. Now, our charter was written when the population of Maui County was 38,000 people, and now it's 160 with 40,000 tourists on our island on average every day. Our budget is over $700 million. And the county's the largest employer in the county, 2,700 people. And the selection criteria for the manager to run that is based in the charter. You have to be a U.S. citizen, you have to be able to vote, and you have to be able have lived here for the last year. In contrast, candidates who seek to become managers in council manager governments, they hire based on job descriptions and minimum requirements as the bar. Now, Maui County did amend its charter back in the 70s to add a position of a managing director. But the position, this is 40 years ago, the position has not evolved. The position is an aide to the mayor. The position does not hire and fire directors. There isn't that alignment of the work to be done. And the position is highly politicized. For those of you who take the Maui News and read the comments by our managing director, in relationship to the Maui film studio fiasco, I'll quote what he said. "Our primary goal above all else is to get the mayor reelected. Nothing else really matters because if the mayor is not reelected, none of us have jobs. Let's be frank, we are all political." That's your managing director. Now, these words were recorded, spoken to other key executive branch personnel, are understandable. I understand them in the context of the current charter, which puts the director's jobs at the mercy of mayoral fortunes, which underscores the urgent need for change because at their core, these words expose an unhealthy insider focus on devotion to a political regime instead of singular dedication to you, to the people's business. Now, here's what needs to be done. Incidentally, there is a special committee that's been formed to look at this. It's ongoing right now. Here are the recommendations we make. Number one, take the mayor's role and separate it out. Recognize that we're at a level of sophistication now that the mayor, elected mayor, retain the elected mayor, so you still have that voice that you just heard about. Have the mayor retain a veto to keep the council in check, just like the mayor has right now. But take the operating functions and put them under the control of a manager who is hired to do that particular job. Now, I mentioned freeing that role from money. To become a mayor of this county, you have to run an election campaign. In 2010 to 2014, $900,000 was raised by the incumbent mayor to retain his seat. Now, by contrast, money plays no role in the hiring of a professional manager. Again, selection is based upon criteria. At its core, professionally managed cities and counties recognize that political skills needed to become an elected mayor are entirely different from the management skills needed to run a complex organization. You know, that's why universities have schools of management. That's why they have master's degrees in business administration or public administration. Second, have the departmental directors report directly to the manager. You need to have that line of control from the professional to other professionals and hire them based upon clear job criteria, their backgrounds and experience. Third, free the manager and free the directors from a term of office that ends arbitrarily and inefficiently with the elected mayor. I mean, we have some dynamite directors. Why should they all go? And secondly, as was reported in the paper recently, it's very difficult to hire directors in a second term of a mayor's office because they know that they're done in 2 or 3 years. You can't build a career. Thank you, Mary. That's a really important thing to get done. Create standard job descriptions. If you look at the job descriptions that are contained in our charter right now, frankly, I don't think they belong in a charter. That's a constitution, but they're very weak. They don't even require subject matter knowledge, by and large, of the areas that are supposed to be led. And if you put people in those positions without subject matter knowledge, how can they lead? Fifth, embed in the charter a manager selection process that insulates it from politics and nepotism and supports broad-based recruitment of qualified candidates resulting in selection of the best among them. Now, in conclusion, county government can be dramatically improved, and structure is the key to achieving this. We can get there with a charter change proposal on the November 2016 ballot, assuming the council approves it, which, if adopted by us, would set up implementation of council-manager government at the end of the current mayor's term. That will allow 2 years in between for transitional planning and implementation. And, you know, to those who would deny us the right to vote on this critical issue, this is a big deal. We've had the charter that we currently have for 50 years. But it's time for change, and I would say that those who are opposed to even giving you a voice in it don't trust democracy. I say give us a vote. Give us a vote, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. And just to clarify, I probably didn't clarify it, but when Mark mentioned the Mega Mall, we don't censor the guests that come here. They make their presentation. No, he was, you know, was stating, well, I said not to talk about it, but I think the audience got the gist of it. Stay on the topic. And he used it in his presentation, so no, we don't. And we've had big challenges to that over the years. Why did you let him say that? Because they're here to present their ideas. So thank you, Mark. And now Mayor Arakawa has 15 minutes.
Thank you very much. You know, a lot of what Mark says makes some sense, except one of the things that he obviously doesn't understand is that we do have a managing system, and we do have a hierarchy in which the county works and how people are hired for the different departments and the deputy positions. Can you think of one department that I have where the director and the deputy director are not qualified? When you look at the different departments, public works, look at all the roles that we're creating. Look at the job that's being done. Parks, look at how the fields are being worked on. Look at what's being repaired. Now, the county system that we started with was never perfect. There were many flaws within the county system. And there have been many attempts by our administration to be able to change a lot of what has been flawed for many, many years. But the process is not simple. We also have to have cooperation by the council. And this is something that is true, and it will be true no matter what system you have, even with the county managing system. Now, under the county managing director system, where the council picks the manager, if the council doesn't like the manager, or if the manager rebels against what the council says, they can fire him instantaneously. There is no guarantee that the manager will be there a day, a week, a year. There are many, many businesses where hired managers come and go pretty much as they feel like, because they get a better job opportunity, better offers. They don't buy into the need to be able to represent the community, and they don't have a heart for the community because many times they're not from the community. In our particular community, we don't have the typical mainland community. Molokai does not want, as a group, to have a lot of tourists, a lot of businesses. They've actually protested and scaled down a lot of it. When we go to Hana, it's a very different community. They don't want to have a lot of hotels, so they don't want to have a lot of things that people in Central Maui might want. Kihei people are very different. Every community that we have has to be understood by the people that manage the community. And a lot of the challenges come about in having to make adjustments. When you ask for bike paths, North South Collector Road, we also have to work with different systems within the state and federal government to be able to get the funding for it. And that's very critical. But we have professional managers now that are working with that and have been doing it for years, which is why you're seeing the improvements that you're seeing, which is why you're seeing all the roads being fixed. We have managers that are looking at trying to improve our county system by being able to take all of our information system and storage system and create a warehouse whereby we can store all of the things that we do that we've been keeping in cardboard boxes for years. We're changing our computer systems to be able to allow different communications for the community so that you can know when the bus is going to be on time or when you're going to have to wait. So you're going to know that you can go to the motor vehicle and get your car registered, look on your iPhone, make an appointment, and at your appropriate time, you'll be notified that it's your time. You don't have to spend your time waiting. If you're lost, all of the different agencies that we have right now, search and rescue, are working together. Different departments helping each other. So when we have someone lost, we have the fire department, the police department, the Coast Guard, the lifeguards, all the different agencies being notified and all swinging into action at one time. This is because of our management system allows it. For a long time, the county government, the administration, has been blamed for a lot of the failures. But you've got to remember, the county budget is actually the council's budget. We make proposals, and when we make the proposals to the council, we have to cut a lot of it out before we even get to the council, and they even cut more to make it even more inefficient. For us to be able to change our computer system from one that's outdated and not even supported has taken us 5 years. Why? Because the council feels that the budget is too large. I could go over issue after issue, but one that Mark has brought up in previous discussions, the Metropolitan Planning Organization, and they said very, very distinctly, and you can see it on Akaku, that the administration should have responded 3 years ago. Let me tell you, the administration took this into account of the council. There have been 19 meetings on this issue. 19 meetings. And I have copies here if anybody wants to know what the dates are, where they were held, what the discussion points were. 19 meetings. The council still has not made up its mind because it's their baby. It's their responsibility to create the commission. They even have three of the council members on it, on a 7-member committee, but they still haven't done anything, so we're waiting. But I got the blame for it. You know, reality is what it is. There are many, many different things that we could do, and there are many things that would be really nice to do, provided you want to bankrupt the community and you just want to go ahead and spend all the money you can. But we have to do things in limitation, and we have to do things with the limitations that we have. We have public employees unions that we have to deal with. We have laws that are state and federal that we have to deal with. We've been dealing with the wastewater situation in Lahaina, where we had followed every state requirement on the injection well, and the judge still ruled that we have to make corrections. But we followed every law. and the departments are required to follow every law. As we go through this, no matter who hires the manager, every manager will react to situations differently. If you have a manager that truly does not have ownership in this community and doesn't know the people in this community, he won't be able to manage the way you as a community would want things to be done and have to change when we need to change. For instance, there were 3 trees in Kihei along South Kihei Road that the community here wanted to save. We had to return, I think, about $8 million in federal funds to keep those 3 trees. But we did it. And we had the Kihei Community Association meet on this as well, and that's what the agreement was, that's what we did. It wasn't pretty because we spent a number of years to get the funding to fix South Kihei Road, and we're still trying to do this. When we have to work with our state, they're looking at a mayor to be able to have, or someone to have, complete responsibility for how we're running our county and what we're going to be asking for. A county manager going to the state legislature and trying to ask for funding is not going to get very far. A county manager won't even be able to go to the U.S. Conference of Mayors and get the things that they want. And if the mayor and the county manager don't agree and are not on the same wave, which is something that does happen, then you have almost entire gridlock. And as far as the council's ability and the mayor's ability to override the council, you know, that in history has proven we're not able to do that. We don't have the real veto power. The council can easily override the mayor's veto, and they've overridden my vetoes every time. So you don't have a check and balance. When the council wants to do things, if we had a manager, there are many, many different things that we would have right now that don't make any sense. Councilmember Okamo wants to put $7 million into infrastructure for affordable housing on Lanai. When we went down there and we did the studies, only 5 to 10 people would qualify for 300 houses. Do you put $7 million into infrastructure for 5 to 10 people? No, but that was a request to put in the budget by the council member. There are many, many issues like this, where as mayor, the check on the council and what they budget, because this is the budget, is that I don't have to do it. As an administration, we decide, we just put that on the side because it doesn't make sense. There was a request for 2 years in a row by the council members to put in a community center in the middle of A and B property on the other side of Maui. They put millions of dollars into the budget for it. We had no site control of the property. We didn't know where the property was going to be. But they wanted us to go ahead and plan and put in a community center. How do you plan for a community center, spend millions of dollars, when you don't even know where it's going to be? How do you draw the plan when you don't know what the topography is going to be, where the roads are going to be, where the sewer lines are going to be, where the water lines are coming from? How do you do it? The check and balance system is critical to what we have because there is no other check to the council. They pretty much do what they want if you don't have the correction. Now, that being said, when you look at what we do and how we formulate our budget, there have been a lot of comments about, well, we don't have plans, we don't have direction. I beg to differ. In this book, our county budget book, every department has an explanation of changes in the budget, goals and objectives, the key activities that they've done through the year, and measurements on how to get to those goals and objectives. We routinely send to the council reports on where we are on our objectives. Now, these objectives are adopted by the council. This document is the council's budget. So everything in here is not administration. In the end, it is the council's budget. But as far as accountability, the council right now gets to see every penny that we spend, where it is, where it's going, they get to approve where we're going to spend every penny. And lots of times they put money in that we don't want to spend. But a lot of it has to do with checks and balances. So all these accusations about us not being able to have plan, not being able to plan. We talked about, Mark talked about the planning process. Well, the planning process was created by Councilmember Charlie Tavares at the time. It was a council process that was put in place. It is still the council process today. And many of the delays, even to the general plan committee, were approved by the council. I don't happen to have a vote on that council to say, hey, let's do the plan quicker. If they feel that the various groups, like the general plan committee, need more time, they go back and they approve more time. If they feel that the community, they need more time for the community plans, they approve more time. If they feel that the administration needs to supply more information in the planning process, we do it. But they approve the time and schedule. If not, we would be on time. But the process isn't perfect. And as a former planning chair for the council, I can tell you that there are many flaws within that system. I could talk about a whole lot of different things as far as efficiencies. But when you don't have a managing director, someone who actually is working with the mayor and being able to set direction for the county, you're not going to have very many innovative changes. The council had very, very few recommendations on changes that need to occur within this community. The purchase of property in Lanipoco along the coastline, picking up almost 80% of the coastline by government to keep it away from erosion and to be able to protect the viewpoint for our residents. Administration. The purchase of a lot of parkland in central Maui and in south Maui and in Lahaina, it wasn't the council, it's administration. The improvements on a lot of these are administration. Changing and changing the base yards, creating base yards, and changing the systems that we're having are administrative changes. There's something that our administration, and we work as a team, all the directors, deputy directors, we meet as a team. And many of the departments have to work together, cooperatively, we work as a team. You're not just replacing one manager. The entire team works together. And the entire team is what the public gets to see, how we work and how we're accountable or not accountable. So changing the system, taking away the authority of running the county by the mayor and by our team, you're also going to be taking away the split because it's administration of the administration of our different departments, and there's also administration of many of the other groups, state, federal, and foreign communities. And we have to do a lot more than just run the county government as is. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much to both of you. I think they each explained their position very eloquently. And this is a community meeting, so now it's your opportunity. Again, please follow the parameters that I mentioned. If you have a question, please raise your hand and wait for Mary to get to you with the microphone. Please don't ask before. Akaku is recording this, and the recording will be somebody asked something, but we couldn't hear it, and then these people are trying to answer it. So please be patient. We'll get to everyone. We've allowed a lot of time for questions. Procedure, when your microphone gets to you, state your name. If you want to stand up, you can probably project better, but we don't require you to stand up. And state who you want, you're addressing the question to. If it's to both gentlemen, just say so. Or if it's one or the other, please name them. So without further ado, we'll open up to questions, and Mary will head towards you when she sees her hand going up, so please be patient.
Hi, I'm Lynn from Wailuku, and I think both of you made some excellent points, so I wanted to thank and congratulate both of you. My question is to both of you, actually. Have you considered maybe proposing a charter amendment to change the job description of each director where maybe the minimum requirements are increased, or, you know, so that you can ensure maybe qualified directors for each department as well as deputy directors? Because that was a concern that you had mentioned, Mark.
Okay, I lost my microphone. Everybody has microphone, but I lost mine. But maybe we can alternate if it's addressed to both. So we'll start off alphabetical, Mr. Mayor.
Why don't you do this and then we'll share one.
Oh, that's terrific. And I wasn't going to impose that on you, but that would be most helpful. Thank you.
I have no objections to putting minimum qualifications on any position. As a matter of fact, most of these positions, the charter, the amendments were put by the public, voted on by the public. So you'd have to go through and make the public change. The council is the one that actually put everything together, and then after that, they can make charter changes recommended. As a mayor, I can't make charter change recommendations, strange as it may sound. So it's really up to the council to make those charter changes if they want to put stricter restrictions in. Quite frankly, you know, that's not a bad idea. But my managing director does have a master's degree. Many of my department heads do have those degrees, and are very qualified degree-wise.
Yes, thank you. That is part of our recommendations, as I mentioned tonight. Now, whether those things belong in a charter, I think, could be discussed. Typically, you wouldn't find that in a constitution. You might. You could find it in an operating manual, but given the history that we have and the weakness of the job descriptions in the charter, I think there might be some public comfort in having more strict criteria in the charter. On the other hand, bear in mind the times change, and if you put, you know, charter changes don't happen very often. So if you build in a certain job description today and some other kind of technology comes up that really is important to be embedded in a particular job, you wouldn't want to have to go back and amend the Constitution to get that done. So I think there could be some general principles in the charter that would require that every department have a job description that does describe the kinds of things that you would find in private industry in terms of background experience. Also, in terms of relevant training, but I leave it a little bit looser than putting it in that location.
Thank you, guys. I'll just interject. We have a second mic person. Patricia has volunteered so we can get to people more quickly. Buck is next.
Buck Joyner. Question. Our government system is based on three different sections: the executive, the legislative, and the judicial. And what you're proposing right now with this change is to put both the all the administrative functions of the executive office under the legislative branch, so that now the county council has complete and total power. And I don't see any purpose for an elected mayor at all. Where, you know, you changed our form of government. So the question is, what would the mayor do under your proposal?
Okay, but it sounds like you're just addressing this to Mr. Hyde, correct? Or both?
Both they like.
Well, it is it's a collaborative model. It's a different model. Now, you know, we talk about balance of power, but how is it working out in Maui County? I mean, it's the relationship between the executive, if this is what you cherish, here, as it's playing out, the relationship between the executive and the legislative branch is broken. And that is really not a good thing. And when you think about you know, if you look at the federal model, you're right, but at the federal level, the president is deciding, do we go to war against Iran? You know, do we have, do we allow gay people to marry? Big social policies. Now, at the county or city level, it's kind of nuts and bolts delivery of service. Get the trash picked up. Make sure water meters get out. That sort of thing. I would, you know, Buck, I would ask you to go take a look at a really interesting YouTube video. It's very short. And you'll find it on the City of Nogales, Arizona website. And it talks about why structurally dysfunction occurs in the municipal setting when you have an elected mayor whose audience is the public, and you have an elected council whose audience is the public, and so they take their arguments to the public and they fight with each other. And so the model that you're seeing here is a model where people work together because they're, you know, they're organized that way, and the elected mayor still has a veto. I mean, what is the check? The check is the veto. If the council gets out of line, now the mayor has said the veto is not very helpful because they just override it. Well, maybe we need to look at a higher threshold for overriding the veto to maintain that balance that you're looking for. Anyway, that's my answer. Thanks.
Let me suggest that probably 95% of what goes on with the county, the council and the administration work well together. When you look at this entire budget and the literally thousands of different items that we have in it, you hear very little about 95% of it. So we do work cooperatively with the council in most issues. There are a few issues that we are very, very far apart on. For instance, the homeless situation. 55 days ago, we had our second meeting. I've called two emergency meetings of the council in my entire time as mayor, and they were both this past year, or last year. First was to inform them about the governor's special declaration of emergency for the homeless, to explain what it was that he was doing. And the second was to propose a plan. That was in November. The council asked me that day if I would rush suggestions to them. And we explained this is preliminary, we're trying to put together a package. But I promised them that the very next day, I would send them a package. 55 days later, they still have not had one single meeting. I am very disappointed, and I am more than a little bit irritated by the fact that they have not had a single meeting. The reason being that after the time period is done for the emergency declaration, in order for us to work with the homeless and to be able to build homeless structures, it's going to cost us over a year in permitting that would have been forgiven under the declaration. So all of the projects that we have to work with, all of the housing that we're trying to create, it's going to take us considerably more time, and it's going to be much, much more expensive. I have a problem with the council creating a situation where the public ends up paying for them not doing their job, which is just having a meeting and a discussion. Then the discussion, if they don't like what we're doing, that's fine. They can make any recommendations they want. They can vote down any suggestions we have, but at least have the discussion so that we know what's going on and the public has a say in being able to understand what's happening with the issue. Now, I consider that a very important issue to this community because homelessness, we're having a lot more crime. We're having a lot more fear in our community, people not wanting to go to the store at night, fear of being accosted. In your communities, there are many people, many circumstances where we're getting complaints. So I consider this important. So we disagree. We're not all going to agree. That's at 5%.
Just as the other two examples I gave you, where they wanted to do a community center where we don't even have site control. Or spend $7 million on infrastructure for 5 to 10 people. We're going to disagree. There are other issues like this, such as how to approach the TAT, Transit Accommodation Tax. The state legislature put together a subcommittee to be able to look at the TAT tax. The task force met, came up with conclusions. All four mayors, Kauai County, Big Island, and Honolulu councils agreed on it. The unions agreed on it. The state legislators agreed on it. The only council that's disagreed with it is our council. And I have a real problem with them going through creating problems with this thing because we might lose our situation with the TAT.
Mr. Mayor, can I ask you to wrap it up so we can get to
the question? There is an absolute need for this checks and balance system. And there is going to be time where we are going to have disagreement. But disagreement is not bad. My wife and I have disagreements. She always wins. It's not bad. At least she knows that I have an opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, next question, please.
Oh, thank you very much. Mike and the other officers, congratulations on leading our association for the next year. Thank you very much for your service. I wanted to ask, I guess, Mark and the mayor, this is a serious discussion, and you guys are really handling it the way I wish the debates were handled. You're doing a great job. Thank you very much. And it is serious. And I do have a question. I'm not sure, maybe that's when we go to Mr. Hyde, Mark Hyde. The water poisoning in Flint, Michigan was caused by a professional manager. What safeguards would be in place here to avoid the potential of a similar catastrophe caused by a trained professional manager with weak or no accountability to the voters? Thank you.
Thank you. I am not familiar with that. I do know that there was an emergency manager appointed. I don't know about a county manager. But you know, making your decisions based upon a one-off thing here and a one-off there, I mean, I could give you a litany of mayors who are sitting in jail. But I don't think it's helpful. I mean, that's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is structure. And are there going to be bad situations in both models? Yes, that's going to happen. That's going to be the exception. The question is, which model is going to produce on a day-in, day-out basis a better result for the people? Now, I believe that's the council manager form with professional management and all the other things that I've described that could go into a charter to create a government that's focused on the people's work, not politics.
You know, it's kind of interesting because I've heard Mark say many times, not politics. And yet, the council is the one that would be appointing this manager. If you think this isn't going to be the epitome of a political appointment, think again. Every time that manager has to make a decision, he's going to be worried about whether he's got a job or not tomorrow. When the council majority puts that person in, if that majority changes, just as our council majority has changed 3 times in the last 4 years, that manager's job could change. He could be gone because the new majority might want to change his style and might not like the way he's doing it and might not like his being associated with the former group. So that could change very, very rapidly. Mark is correct about the structure, but the structure that he's proposing has many flaws and very, very few guarantees. There is no guarantee that you're going to have a professional group, because when we started trying, and I'll use a very quick example, the teachers, we were short of teachers, so we started advertising and paying people $100,000 just to come down and teach in our schools in Hawaii. Those teachers didn't last very long. They didn't stay very long. They took the $100,000. Many of them left right after that. They didn't understand the community and didn't have the heart for the community. And I keep going back to the people that are running this county need to have a heart in this community. They need to have buy-in. If I mess up right now,
My wife, my cousins, my brother, my friends, they all know where I live. And trust me, they're gonna tell me. Buck will come to me and he'll tell me, you know, you're really messing up. But we have buy-in with the community because we've been here, we understand the community, and I have to come out to each and every one of you and sell my case all the time. There is a definite check and balance, and the balance is you, the public. You having a say in the system that is being proposed. You have a pseudo-mayor, and I can tell you that that pseudo-mayor, if he doesn't have the connectivity with what's happening in administration, you're gonna have huge political ramifications on the decision-making of that managing director. So, we'll leave it there. So, think about it. If your job was dependent on a majority in the council, would you or would you not listen to what they're telling you? Would you go against them? If you didn't come from this community and you could find another job someplace else, would you take the heat in this community or would you go someplace else where it's easier? It's very simple logic.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Okay, next question, please.
Hi, Gene. Mark, this might be a question more directed at you because I think the mayor has already talked about it. You know, our council of nine members represent distinct communities, and so I imagine the budget's like a horse trading session. How would the managing director have handled, or what latitude would the managing director have to handle the two examples that our mayor spoke about? In other words, the council wanted this study done on Lanai, and the mayor didn't do it. And then they wanted this community center plan, and the mayor didn't do it. What would happen to the managing director if he felt, I'm not gonna enforce the budget? That was a light.
Thank you, Gene.
Well, that's an interesting question because, you know, one of the issues that we have right now is council will pass a budget and the mayor will decide it's not a good idea and not do it. And that's not so good. So the way the council manager form of government works is it's like a corporate model in a way where there is a dialogue, continuing dialogue and discussion between the chief administrative officer and the council about those things, where they literally sit in the same room. Most of these managers attend every council meeting. Ours meets twice a month. He or she sits there with them. They talk about things. Now, we've heard an awful lot tonight about the council doesn't do this, they don't do that. And also, I pointed out some of the barriers that exist to communication. That dialogue's not happening. I mean, we've talked about, there's a memorandum that's been issued by the executive branch to control the kind and flow of information between the two. It's gotten to that point. So when you have that broken system, then things break down. But if you have a collaborative relationship with a manager, and certainly if the manager's not doing his job, yeah, you've got a leash on him. You know, to say, we want you to do this. And of course, it's a majority vote. It's not one person saying, this is what you're gonna do. So I really think that there is greater connectivity, greater alignment of the work to be done. And I also believe that when people work together, much more gets done. In my business, I had a medical director who had this chart he would show to employees, and it was very simple. It had everybody in a canoe paddling together. Now, if you put people in a canoe and some are paddling this way because of this, and some are paddling that way, the canoe doesn't go anywhere. So that's my answer, Gene.
Hi. Let me give you a clarification because he's bringing a very specific issue up. And I'm going to read a little bit from the county charter because it's making like I'm doing something that the charter is, it's contrary to what is there. And this is from the power of the council. And it's under 3.3-65 to require periodic and special reports from all county departments concerning their function and operation. Such reports shall be requested and submitted by and through the mayor. That's written black and white as part of our county charter. Now, what I was suggesting and what I have done as an administration is I've allowed a lot of flexibility to that. But the requirement for it is actually in the charter, and this issue that Mark is talking about never occurred. It was me pointing out to Gladys Bice at the time that this was part of the charter, and let's try to avoid getting to the point where they cannot talk to the council. Our administration is at almost every single county meeting, council meeting. They request, we send people ad nauseum. I mean, sometimes they got six or seven of our directors sitting on one meeting for maybe one question each. But we send them. When they ask us for information, there are literally thousands of pieces of information we give the council. It doesn't matter what they're going to do with it. If they make the request, we're required to give it to them. So we give them volumes of information. And after this meeting, Sandy Boz is over here, he's my budget director. Go ask him how his section has to put together literally volumes of information just for the council at their request.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you for your patience. You had your hand up several times, but we got to you. Go ahead, please.
Donna Howard moved here to Hawaii in 1968. And my question, Mark, is, have we considered the county executive form of government where the members of the council are elected by district and the district chair is elected at large? There is no mayor, but the entire council, including the chair of the council, appoints the executive of the county.
And you're addressing that to both of them?
Yeah.
Thank
well,
you.
Well, mostly to Mark.
Okay,
well, you know, district voting, first of all, you raise a couple of issues in your question, and district voting is one of them. The Charter Commission in 2012 chewed on that, and there is certainly a voice in the community for district elections, and there are others who don't want district elections, and for whatever reason, they did not come forward with that recommendation. Now, I see that as a separate issue from this, and I also believe that you can only do so much at one time. If we are lucky enough to transition to council manager government, and that's how I see it, lucky, that's a big change. And the next Charter Commission in 2022 can wrestle again with that. Now, I and many others have been out talking to the community about this change. And one of the things that we've heard pretty loud and clear, and it's changed my thinking, is that the community does want an elected mayor. They want to have that go-to person. And so in our thinking, that we would retain an elected mayor with a veto power. And I know Buck is shrugging his shoulders, and I understand. And these things are, you know, they're trade-offs that have to be done. But specific to your question, no.
Let me suggest that. Mark is right. If you go and talk to the community, they want an elected mayor. They want somebody that can be responsible. If the mayor doesn't have ability to control the system of government that we have, when people are calling in with complaints about roads, when they're calling in about complaints about just about everything, as a mayor, I call down to the departments, and the departments go out and do things. What good is an elected mayor if he can't get the departments to go and do the work that needs to be done within the community? What good is a mayor if there's a problem, he can't have the departments address it because he has no control over the departments? It makes no sense at all, except that Mark and his group found out that the public really actually wants to have an elected mayor. So they want to now make him a pseudo-mayor in form only, but not have the ability to actually make the changes that the community needs or requests. We have thousands of requests that go through our office by people in our community to kind of try and fix virtually everything you can think of. Our sewer system is blocked up. I need to cross the road. Can you put in a crosswalk? Can you put up traffic lights like they put up in Kihei? I mean, you name it, and we've had somebody come up with needs. Directly being able to talk to the mayor and mayor's office, and it's not just me, I have my office and my staff to be able to direct that down to the department. It's critical to be able to get the changes that you need. And I can hold my directors and deputies responsible for making those changes. If you have a appointed mayor or appointed manager, who's going to force that manager? And why should the manager have to listen to anybody in the public? His boss is on that council.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to inject here, guys. We're going to take two more questions, but those of you who are regulars know that at some point I cut in, because when we go to finish up and I go to try and mention about the next meeting, everybody is gone out the door. So just to alert you, a topic that's been brought up in these two gentlemen's discussion is the homeless issue, and that's going to be the general topic of our March meeting. And so far, we do have the new Director of Housing and Human Concerns, Carol Ryman, has agreed to come. I'm springing this on our community police officers. We're thinking as a possibility one or both of them could participate in the panel. But that's the topic, that's who's coming so far. So now we'll go to the final two questions. Mandy?
This is from Mark. Mark, how long has the manager type of government been in existence, and how long does a manager generally stay in that position? You know that?
Yes, I know that. The county manager or council manager form of government began around early 1900s, so it's been around for well over 100 years. And as I mentioned, it is the most prevalent form of municipal and county government across America, in cities and counties of our size. Now, it's different in smaller towns, and it's different in large cities, but we don't fall in either one of those categories. What was your second question? I forgot.
Tenure.
Oh, tenure.
Yeah.
You know, I heard a statistic the other day. I've not done the research, but I heard a statistic of 7 years on average. And, you know, some have been around for 20, 30 years, and some have been around for one or two. And again, it's performance-based, you know, but it's not 4 years. 4 years, you know. It is flexible depending upon the circumstances. And if a manager's not performing, you don't want him sitting around for 7 years. You want him gone. And so that's a good thing, not necessarily a bad thing. Yeah.
Ms. Mary?
Mark keeps saying 4 years, but you know, for the most part, it's either 4 or 8 years. And for the most part, all of the directors, deputy directors, have that option to stay for the full 4 to 8 years. And when you're finding, if you average out all the different positions that you have to have, you're going to find that it's very, very difficult. I didn't bring the statistics, although I have them on my desk, but I think that the system that we have right now, there's actually more longevity on the average when you put it together. Most of the directors or deputy directors, if they leave because of retirement or some major calamity under the mayor system, because they have an attachment to the mayor. Under the others, they can leave for any reason that they want.
Thank you. Last question.
My name is Donnie from Kihei. This is a question I wanted to ask the mayor for about a year, and I'd like to have Mark Hyde also get involved with the answer. 23,000 voters voted in a law that won, and it was a vote to prove that what GMOs are being grown on this island are being
done. All right, sir, that's exactly what we asked you. No, sir,
no, but
you're next.
But the question is, what would a manager do differently with the mayor?
Sir, we're not addressing that issue. We were very clear about it. Thank you.
The management question.
Mary, that lady in the back, that she's had her hand up for quite a while.
She's ready to ask one question. I'm ready.
She has?
Yeah.
I address this to both people. If you were going to hire somebody for a very complex management job, wouldn't you go try getting the most qualified person and look at his total background stuff instead of just getting somebody that wins on a popularity contest?
Let me suggest that if there's a complicated issue, we have the option of hiring special managers and consultants, and we do that on a regular basis. There are many, many issues that we have to deal with within our county that we don't have the absolute expertise to be able to handle. So we hire consultants, just like the Guernsey study that just came out on the electric company. We hire consultants. We hire, and we can advertise throughout the nation for people to be able to look at what we have and to be able to actually give us some of the best information we possibly can. We send our personnel out to conventions or to specifically research a lot of this stuff, but we bring in, and that's one of the things that we can do, is bring in the best and brightest if we don't have the answers ourselves. And I don't think any one person or any one group are going to have all the answers. So the obvious answer is we should have the best and brightest. We do get the best and brightest. They don't necessarily work for us full time, because we may not need the best and brightest as a contractor or on any one topic like ocean scientists, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. But as we need them, we go to the university and we bring in the best. As we need the, we can find that talent, and that's what we do. And in our budget, that we're allowed to do that. Thank you.
Hiring people, you want to put the best people in the right places. I mean, that's a basic business principle. The right people in the right places. And the way you get the right people in the right places is through a process. And that's a management process. And a management process begins with a clear definition of the job to be done, a clear definition of minimally what you would look for, so that you would take the applicants and put those over here who don't qualify, and then work with these that do qualify. And it would be a decision that's free from politics, and it would be based on the best possible candidate. So I agree with your question, I think, is that there is a protocol for doing those things and getting the very best people, and that should be followed. And management, people who are steeped in management understand this is a very basic principle.
Okay, guys, can we give it up for these two gentlemen? Certainly don't speak for them. They were good enough to come, but quite often, if you have more questions, people will stick around and try and give you an answer. The only thing we ask is to gravitate outside, because we have to reset the room for the Kihei Charter School kids in the morning. So please don't have the discussions in here. You can start them, but start it now.